We are good to go.
This is about Breeze. We'll start talk out, start out talking about who is Breeze. Scholastically, probably was no Breeze. It seems that the title Breeze was that title. And the Celtic language, they use these titles. And then when other people came, when the Romans came especially, they, heard everybody saying Breeze, Breeze, Breeze. Naturally, they began to assume that Breeze was the goddess or was the person. And that's not really a problem. Whatever she was or wasn't in the past, she's Breeze now. Look to her and as a goddess. We are got all of these things that we trust, these ideals, these emotions, these scholarly research, and all these different gods and goddesses. And we latch on to something that means uplifts us, that holds us together. Of course, that's what I need right now. But, and Breeze has always been there. In the beginning of my paganism, everyone assumed that, that a guy named Carcharo would be wearing a Roman sword and shield. But it hasn't turned out that way. And that's, I do have ancestry from the Isles. My grandfather on my mother's side was part Irish, part German, part Scandinavian. I never met him, but I guess he was a wild ride. And a hard guy to get along with. But, a lot to me. She sits in my living room, and course, being that I don't work, I sit home with the dogs and Bree. And so the origins of Bree are in the Celtic Islands. Celtic worship, Celtic practice. But Celtic wasn't just in the Isles. It wasn't just in Ireland. Roman areas in Italy, throughout different areas in Europe, and Greece. The ideal, the meaning, the spirit that people share about Greece is so strong. It's unusual for me to start out saying, well, there was no Greece, and it was just a title and misunderstood, and then try to tell you how palpable she is today. Greece is everywhere. Later she became a saint, and that was an unusual thing. There are not too many of our pagan gods and goddesses who achieve sainthood. And I'm not afraid of that. Her being a Catholic saint helped her to endure, I think. Helped her to help the pagan mythos accomplish. There are so many Grecians that, there are nuns, and nuns have, convents, and there are so many different pagan groups that are dedicated to Greece, and so many does. Normally I would probably look for the least followed and most obscure god or goddess, and that's where I would latch on, but somehow Reach came to the fore.
Talk a little bit about what her attributes are and what she is known for.
We will. Greece is the triple goddess. Put away all the nonsense, we're just going to adhere to the fact that this goddess works for me, and it seems to work for a lot of people. And religion is all about finding what you need. I mean, that's what I believe. Finding what you believe.
Here.
Finding what you need.
Are we going to touch on the voodoo aspect?
Yeah.
Okay, that excites me.
Let's wait to the end. bad for scary stuff.
Oh, come on.
When I'm not well, I go to Greece. Kind of latched on to her now. I don't feel well emotionally. I don't feel well mentally. I just have to be very, we just say that. I suffered the seasonal effect. Some years it's worse than others. A week or so ago, I thought, well, I'm over it. And, but then, no, I'm not. And, I probably would be hospitalized if it wasn't for my connection with Greece. I suffered a great loss a week ago, and my brother passed away, and I have several brothers and a sister. I have two sisters, actually. But my brother Dominic was the closest of my brothers emotionally and just connection, and we shared so many of the same interests and hunted together for years and years. And, we're able to just sit and drink and smoke cigars together. And that's a habit that I've since given up. My wife won't let me smoke a cigar in the house. But with that, I know that trying to deal with loss in the past has been a very difficult thing. Is helping me to get through it. Talking about Breeze, the healer. She's the lady of the sacred waters throughout Europe. People go to the pools and they go to the wells. Back with them to solace them. There's hope for them. No matter what your circumstances is, no matter what your affliction is, I'm here to say that there's hope for tomorrow. That Breeze is the bringer of hope.
Because he not only lived, but he is actually thriving now. And I attribute part of that to asking her for help. But if you give me this, I'll give you that kind of offering, rather than giving her the offering up front, just because I really wanted it to happen. So I figured she'd give a little extra effort for it. To get the altar, so I got some parts ready. I have a copper fire pot that's going to be one of the main parts of it, because you know, she is a bit fiery herself. So.
So over 11 years ago, I had a really bad heart attack, and Greece was the goddess that helped me get through it. And so after that, I recovered, and my daughter had said to me while I was in the hospital that, Mom, if you get better, we'll go to Ireland. So I did, and we went, and my granddaughters, and we went to Kildare pilgrimage, and we got to go to Bridgewell, and that was my first trip. And when I came back, I joined ADF, because I'd been thinking about it for a long time anyway, and I'd already been reading a lot of the books by Isaac and other people in ADF, and I decided to join Bridget's SIG, and then I became a flame keeper. So I've been a flame keeper for about 10 years now, and I have an altar for Greece in my house. I've had a really close relationship with her, and I didn't have a mother like other people's mothers. I did have an excellent grandmother, though, but Grisha said a lot of the mothering things that I needed in my life for me. And then I had another heart attack a couple of months ago. And when I was about to go into surgery, I really felt like she was with me, so I wasn't scared at all. I was totally, you know, confident that I was going to be okay. And everything went okay. Good with the surgery, so and then it made me even closer with her. So I have a really close relationship.
I think, of course, I really wasn't working with Rage until we became more than friends, and I think her source, I feel her more from inspiration. I recently got back into, I had to take a literature course as a final humanities department to complete my degree, and I used to read and write a lot when I was a kid. I kind of got away from it. And I'm like, so I see the syllabus, I'm like, oh, are you kidding me? I'm like, I got to read all this stuff and write. And I asked her, I asked her, she sits in her house, and I said, well, what should I do? And she's like, well, dummy. Like the Morgan would tell you, just go with it and see what happens. And I feel more inspiration, and which is, can be healing to me. Especially journaling and writing has helped me get through a lot of stuff too. Not so much physical, but mental. Because I lost my dad 2 years ago, and I was having a hard time with it. But I started journaling and writing and reading. And so she has more been inspirational. Me healing mentally and getting me back into writing, which is something that I definitely gonna go back into and pursue. I love writing stories and different kinds of things. So she's touched my life more of her inspirational aspect. I also view her differently a little bit. I think she's pretty kick-ass too. And I like, and I know this is hard for people to believe, I like people who are kick-ass, okay? Like, are a little bit not so conventional. And you know, I first actually learned about Brige when I was raised Catholic. And that's where my first encounter with her was. And of course, I started to ask more questions when I got about in my teenage years. And I said, I wonder who she's based on. So I asked the priest one day. And said, I did some reading in a book. He goes, yeah. It's a little old Latin, okay? Everything was in Latin at the time. And I said, so basically you took her from the pagans? Oh, well, I was the devil child at that point. So that's what kind of inspired me then when I decided, you know, to transition into pagan. So that's, she's been different things to me, and I think we can all take away something different from Brige as well. But that's, she's more inspirational to me. In writing and being kick-ass, and you know, she's she can be a motherly aspect, like you said, but not to me so much. But and she always seems to back up my patron Morgan for some reason. Like, you should have listened, dummy. So that's my experience with her.
I'm sure we've all had experiences with the sacred waters. We the sacred water thing in our rituals, and I'd really like to,
Road trip, let's go.
Once we hit the lottery, we'll take a big road trip.
Oh, that'd be awesome, yeah. We better start playing. What's the deal tonight? What's the pot?
Tonight's a little one, only 40.
Oh, that's not, no, we gotta wait.
Then there's Bridget Breeze the Bard. I look at a name and I automatically want to just, say Bridget. There's Brigitte, Brigantia, then we say Breeze, and that was a curious thing in the beginning, because, and then as I got to learn and read different things, she means so much to so many different people. Her names come out of their languages, and it's because she, fills a lot of different roles in people's lives and in people's homes, and I'm sure that each one of us can attest to that. Now that was Bridget the Healer of the Sacred Waters. Now there's, Bridget the Bard. And she's a, not only bard in the sense of the folks that run around singing songs and while that's an aspect, music and the skill of music, but it's also, she's the goddess of multiple skills. And that's kind of one of the things that attracted me to her, is her being the goddess of the arts and craftsmanship. People that know me know that I take on a lot of different hobbies and a lot of different skill sets, and I really feel her inspiration, when I'm getting into something new, and or even when I'm tackling something that I've done for years and years. There was earlier a time when, I'm a seamstress, which is a skill set that was handed down to me from my grandmother, my mother, and my sister, and I learned from them. I make wonderful kilts. And ask Skip, he'll show you a picture of his. But the arts and craftsmanship, she's it probably comes out of the fact that she's beyond antiquities. Her influence, her the passion people had for her, settles back to time when civilization was first coming together, and the development of skill sets was important to forming civilization. And as people developed specific skills and contributed that to community, contributed that to growth, it would be somebody working at the forge, someone making wine, someone making stronger spirits, good cooks. We can never have enough good cooks. But Bridget is the goddess of the arts and craftsmanship. Um, How has she inspired you? Any of you?
I know, for us in many ways, I think she was sort of the goddess of us becoming homeowners.
It's a big undertaking.
That part of our right to claim possession of the home after we had done all of the after we'd become its owners in the sight of men was that we did a number of things to establish our residence, our stewardship in the sight of the kindreds as well. And I remember very clearly what you said and did about, you know, here I stand with flame in my hand. That, what is it, the hearth is laid, ready to be lit, or something like that?
It was a prayer, I think, that David wrote. Yeah.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. And she probably has the most overt, dedicated space in our home of identity. And we have the altar space, which is sort of general. Mm-hmm. But there's a little chunk of our kitchen where there's a, what is it, like a photo collage or something, and a candle votive, and a little dish for pouring milk in, so right by our stove.
I wish I had room in my kitchen to put an altar. That's really the ideal place.
Our altar space for her is probably
it's like a 5x8 photo frame.
It's probably about as big as this program. There's the photo frame and the cup and the thing, and it's in between the toaster oven and the spoon rest. So.
And the fire extinguisher.
Oh, Bridget's crosses are also very good for preventing fires. So you definitely have one of them in there.
Well, let's talk about fire. Bridget as the fire goddess. Bridget as the fire goddess, you know, she's a smith. One of those skills. And most people are kind of like hesitant to talk about being on the forge. Being in the fire, and those are things that I believe are necessary, that are pruning, that are when I heat a coin, it gets all scaled up, and then first time I whack it, it's like it's great because that scale just kind of pops and flies all over the room. But then there's a fine, you know, even though it might just be a quarter or half dollar that I'm working with, and, you know, something that I pulled out of my pocket or ordered, got from the mint or someplace on eBay, that I begin to feel the energy after that first annealing, like, wipes away whatever history was there, and whatever negativity might be there, wipes that scale comes off. It's like purging, it's cleansing it, purifying it, and it's making it ready to shine. Must have been very exciting, you know, to be around, to be smith work in back in the days when men first began to forge with iron and bronze works and things like that. And there's really so much that you can do with just a little chunk of metal. And I think each piece that I make, you know, even though you know, sometimes I get it in a die and it twists and it's just it's just completely wonky. And come over to my table, I'll show you some real wonky stuff. But the wonky is special because I set them aside to use, to give back, to give in thanks, to because the forge, the fire, the removal of the dross, and you know, those are all like way beyond, those are terms beyond what I do in my simple little corner of the garage. But it's a purging aspect. It may be tough, it may be difficult to have to go through something, you know, owning a home is wonderful. We moved into MJ's dad's home after he passed away and did a bunch of work and did different things. But, you know, some things happen unexpectedly. Pipes will break. You could be changing the shower and, you know, it's some of those little tubes in a faucet twist when you don't expect them to. And, you know, getting a shower faucet out of the wall after you've done that is not an easy thing to do, but it's got to be done. So you bust a bigger hole in the wall. And a lot of times that's what, you know, Bridget is trying to do with us. She's trying to, we ask, and then we ask for more, you know, opportunities to change, things within ourselves that we'd like to see improved, or opportunities to do things over again. And, you know, it's going to require sometimes that she bust a bigger hole in the wall. And, when that happens, we wonder, well, why would I have prayed that? we all like the easy change, you know. The change from like fourth to fifth grade is not that big of a deal. But when you graduate from college and now you're out working or having to find a job, that's a big transition. And for me, having the goddess Breeze working in my life helps me to it's like ride the waves without going up and down so much. Mm. You know, she carries me across the crests of the waves. And you know, and then you sit down in the evening and you can be thankful for the change. Thankful that you've gone through something. She's helped me to get through it. And be confident that she will be helpful again and again. Here's an interesting aspect that I found out about Maurice. The goddess of the oak. We all like talking about oaks. We got oak trees on our t-shirts. We've got acorns in our sigils and in our emblems that we use for our groves and things of that nature. And the oak is like the druid tree, right? And this is one of the areas where you see strong leaning of Bridget into the pagan community. The goddess of the oak is she's the sacrificial. Sacrificial Virish. In that, the you know, in Kildare, I guess this is one of the best ways I can demonstrate this. They have the, or had, or have again, I'm not sure, the perpetual fires. And they were always oaks. It was always, they always used oak to burn the fires. So that's most likely where this association comes from. And not only oak is, used in fires, has to be like burned twice in order to be really good and long lasting for some reason. And I imagine that they burned, you know, big chunks of oak trees and took that charcoals and added it to the flames on a regular basis and kept that tending. The sacrificial breeze. So as the oak sacrificed itself to perpetuate the eternal flame, I think Breach is asking us to make sacrificial use of our time and our lives. This is most difficult for me because this is where I really lack in my commitment to Breach, is the way that I use my time and any in any sacrificial aspect. I'm just selfish that way. I can't explain it any other way. But the sacrificial breeze wants us to lay down a part of ourselves, lay down, you know, we don't sacrifice animals, we don't do that kind of thing. We come to group and rituals, and you know, we pull out a bag of oats or whatever, and throw that in a pot, and I'm not afraid to do those things or say that those things are okay, because I've gotten a lot of growth and personal development out of the simple offering in ritual, the sacrifice, and to the Lord. But then when I come home and I sit in my chair and Breeze is on the other side of the room, you know, she's always asking me to go deeper. She's always asking me to go to find a deeper place where pools of living water, if I can like pull that out of some Christian concept from my past, can that would boil up within me, but cool the mind, cool the heart, it's you know, the use of our time. Let's talk about Skip.
Which these things, my cards.
Your cards?
They're in that bag right over there.
Oh, okay.
You don't have to pull them up. They're right
there. They're right there. But each of those sets took a certain amount of time to create, and are an investment made. Breeze, in the sacrificial aspect, is coming alongside of each and every one of us and saying, I'll help you.
She does.
You know, and all we have to do is pick up a chunk of oak and throw it in the fire, pick up a pen and start doodling drawings, and you know, they turn into decks of cards. Or you know, you know, pick up some coins and put them on a stretcher, turn them into a ring. Take some material and, you know, cut it, sew it back together, cut some more off, and sew some more on, and make something useful, practical, enjoyable, improving our lives. The I have a set of Skip's first deck of cards, and I get a lot of joy in out of using them. Well, let me go back to my original thought. She will come alongside of us and help us not only to get endure it, but enjoy it, and yeah, make something useful and practical within the community. Let the community grow, right?
Yeah.
And, well, let's move on. There's, Breeze are not often thought of as a battle goddess, you know, but she's right out there in the midst of the battle. And but you know, mostly we think of like the Morrigan or some of the Norse goddesses and being all battle burly. And MJ and I watched the TV show The Vikings, and it's, I need to stop saying that, I'm sorry. It amazed me how that the women were portrayed in their battle aspect and still remained different than the men. You know, I won't say that they were, you know, it would be demeaning to say they were still pretty or they were still feminine or they were still whatever. That would not be nice in this day and age. But you kind of get what I'm saying as I said it. But
that the feminine can be fierce and in battle without losing the fact that it is feminine.
Thank you. Breeze, the goddess of battle, and you know that's an amazing thing in itself. You know, to know that you have somebody beside you who's ready to, you know, pull a sword and cast down and or kick ass, whatever. That's probably one of the things that I'm truly thankful for in my life that, she handled that sword pretty good last night. And, but there's not a situation I think that I could, that any of us could come into. I cannot imagine there being a circumstance where Breeze was not able or willing to throw down right beside us. That not willing, she's the goddess of the forge, and you get around them fires and you sweat. And you get around them, swinging a hammer all day is not a pretty thing. You know, I barely, you know, even though what I'm doing with my rings nowadays is forging, I barely consider that actual, you know, by comparison to what they had to work with in the old days. But it's still, you know, in this, that little bit of imagery, it's still difficult. It's still, it requires me to, like, sometimes just get over it and put all my weight down into something. And telling these stories, and then I'm losing my train of thought again. Where's the warrior? I like that Breeze. It's like when I'm sitting in my living room and there she is. She's beautiful. I had to endure a time where people make fun of the fact that I once said that she's my spiritual lover. And my wife never lets me forget that. But in that strength and in that a willingness to get right alongside of me and fight for me, and that's really what it is. I'm not asking her to fight. I'm not asking her to go to battle, but she is willing to go to battle for me, and not only for me but with me. And she's able, she's willing, she would like to be that strength in each and every one of our lives, be that grit, that teeth-gritting woman of achievement, accomplishment, and battle, the battle, battle goddess. Let's talk about Imbolc. Imbolc is the feast day that we recognize Bridget in. And she, in our grove, well, she's a triple goddess, and she's recognized in a triple way in our ritual. We use her in our Imbolc rite as the gatekeeper and the goddess of the occasion, and, you know, speaker to bring the omen. Imbolc, she's the springtime goddess. Now, Grease is associated in the springtime with the, like, the birthing of the lambs and, you know, setting out the seed in preparation for planting. She's the motherly goddess we think of. Sometimes we all just need a lap to lay our head on. And Breeze has that lap for us. She's our mother, and not only our mother, but she's midwife to the things that we want to accomplish or that she would like to see accomplished in our lives. There's just so many ways that you can describe her as helping us. You know, there's a circle of, the circle of life or whatever. The circle of her influence in our lives. Looking at each aspect, it's not about, like, she's the great and mighty one, and we, we beg, and she sends a little godness down to us. It's not like that at all with Bree. She's always right there beside us. She's always helping us. In just like in helping the animals birth in the springtime and in the barns and everything and everywhere, she's at least in my life. Anytime I have a new idea or want to create something new or want to cook something new, she's helping. She's ushering. She's Breeze is wonderful. Breeze is wonderful. Maybe. Somehow, I'll tell you how. A long time ago, there were tens of thousands of Irish men and women indentured themselves to come over to the Isles in the South Pacific, the Atlantic, Jamaica and them kind of places, to work. And those indentured servants brought with them their Celtic habits, their beliefs, their way of life, their lifestyle. That's the word I'm looking for. And along with that lifestyle, Greece came. And this is the part that NJ's looking forward to. Mm-hmm. At the same time, the folks from Africa came over and didn't have it nearly as well an opportunity. Their servanthood was meant for a lifetime. But they brought their religion, their customs, and their beliefs. And somehow the two kind of got mixed up. They're not mixed up, but Breeze is the goddess that goes and establishes herself, establishes her way the best way that she can, and that's why she became a saint, to continue her so that her peoples can continue their influence in the world. And coming to the Americas, she got involved with the Voodooing. And Maman Brigitte was born. And she took a husband, and her husband was a baron, Baron Samadhi. He, I don't know that much about him. Time. Okay, I'll get to the end then. I don't know that much about the Buddha. I plan to change that because Baban is speaking to me. But, all of the dancers you see on the YouTube videos, you know, are, they're the typical what you would think of as guru and practitioners. And like Maman Brigitte is this white woman with blonde hair, and she stands out in that crowd. And she found herself in the Lao of the cemetery. And here's another example of how the name thing is not a thing. When a cemetery is established, the Voodoo tribes or the Voodoo customs, the first woman placed in the cemetery is the Breeze. Mm. She's the Maman Brigitte. And you know, she watches over the cemetery, and you know, that's her job. The first man placed there, her husband was Baron Samadhi. Hope I'm pronouncing that right. And the first man placed in the cemetery is the Baron. The Baron, his role in the Lao is a little different to Brigitte's. He's the Lao of the grave. What took place beneath the ground. And it's something I hope to be able to share more next year or another time. The I'm gonna close just to well up and say how amazing this goddess is to me. Amazing. If you haven't, take an opportunity, pick up a book, go to YouTube, whatever, get to know her. I mean, it's a, you know, my relationship with like the Norse gods are very powerful, but more surface. They're like, they're still like cartoon characters to me, even though, you know, way beyond what Marvel has to offer. But in comparison to the depth that you will find working with Breeze, is just like the difference of night and day. There's there's power. I don't know where some of these things are coming out of my head, but we used to sing a song that said, "There's power, power, wonder-working power." And I have to rewrite the song for Breeze now. She's amazing. As you need, find an intimate place with her, and you'll be amazed at what she can do in your life. With the strength and the beauty she will turn things. And let me give you one more example. We have two chihuahuas that came to us as elderly dogs, missing teeth, and ragged, bred by their former owners to, just beyond what's reasonable. And because the dogs are with me every day, they are involved in my spiritual practice, sitting on my lap or whatever. And Bridget has changed these two dogs from being so skittish when they first came, apprehensive, maybe the wisdom she gave me and how to deal with them is what has been the difference, or just her presence near them, day and night, because they sleep right near Bridget's statue. But it's transformed them into two of the most loving and outgoing dogs. More and more youthful every day. I mean, even Josie gets up and runs around once in a while. But Breeze is also the goddess of the animals. Whether the lambs or the chihuahuas.
Cats love her.
And
Carrie, can I tell a short story?
Yes,
another one to illustrate the power of Breeze?
Yes.
At the Starwood Festival in 1999, ADF was charged with doing the main Thursday night Midnight Rite.
Oh, I remember this one.
Yes. During the day, Ian Corrigan had led a workshop to create a spirit house that was going to be the main sacrifice. Everybody was going to put their offerings in that. And then at the time of the final sacrifice, that was going to go up on top of the fire. This is talking about a fire as wide at the base as that table and probably 8 foot tall, 7 or 8 foot tall.
So small.
Yes. There's probably 150 people gathered around it at the right. Fox was officiating as archdruid, I was officiating as vice archdruid, and Isaac was the third officiant. So we got to the point for the main sacrifice. The four people came up with the lawn poles, reached way up over their head, and put this on top of this great big fire that's been burning for half an hour. And we stand there and wait for the fire to burn it up. Well, 10 minutes later, we're still looking at each other and looking over at Ian going, what the fuck is happening? Finally, Eric Anali, one of our senior priests, happened to realize that somebody had put a Bridget's cross right up at the top of the shrine house. So he stood up and started singing the Irish version of Isaac's song, A Hymn to Breech. Isaac and Ian joined in, and everybody else in the circle that knew the song. By the time we'd sang the Irish version and then the English version, the shrine house was burning, blazing away, and all of the offerings were being burned up. So Breech is very powerful, especially through her symbols of the Bridget's cross, to prevent fires.
That's a sense of humor.
Yeah, it has a sense of humor.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
So we said, yeah, it's fine to burn this. Oh, okay.
That is exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. All right. I did my scary stuff, now Rob will do his.